Welcome to the MIT IT Innovation Program podcast. This is a repository of insights by thought leaders and practitioners of innovation where they speak about their views, insights, and experiences. Come join us.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Innovation in Times of Crisis. My name is Priya Dhawan, and I contribute as the head of collaborations, branding, and outreach to the MIT IT Innovation Program. This is our 11th webinar since lockdown started, and I'm grateful to be amongst you all hosting this informational session today. I'm pleased to introduce our guest speaker, Mr. Amitabh Ray, Managing Director of Ericsson India Global Services. An alumni of Columbia University, Columbia Business School, Amitabh has 3+ decades of leadership roles in Ericsson, IBM, and PwC. He specializes in building large ICT organizations and establishing global hubs for top Fortune 500 companies in the areas of R&D, product development, sales support, and services delivery. With extensive experience in corporate strategy, management consulting, change management, and systems integration, Amitabh has developed and managed a diverse group of clients in both private and government sectors in Asia, Europe, and the United States. After spending years working in the Silicon Valley, USA, and Europe, Amitabh has been acknowledged by the industry as an inspirational keynote speaker and a great technology visionary. He has been speaking at different national and global forums for the last 20 years on a range of technology subjects and is known for the enthusiasm, humor, dedication, and passion with experience. A TEDx speaker and a prolific blogger, Amitabh has made it to the covers of different technology magazines and has been quoted in a number of publications on important corporate and future technology issues. He has been nominated to the prestigious list of LinkedIn Power Profiles in India for 4 years and is recognized by the Insight Success magazine as top 30 young and dynamic entrepreneurs. Prior to joining Ericsson, Amitabh worked as vice president in IBM and as a partner at PricewaterhouseCoopers. So before we proceed to listen to Amitabh, I have a few updates to share about the session and the MIT IT Innovation Program webinar platform. Firstly, today's webinar will have the guest speaker share his insights for the first half hour, followed by questions facilitated by me in the latter half hour. Next, we encourage you to be curious and ask questions. If you have a question for our speaker, please feel free to share it via the Q&A tab above. If we don't get to your question during today's webinar, we will surely follow it up with answers offline. This webinar will be available after the session on our various social channels. Do stay updated about future webinars and online lectures. We would like to encourage you to share today's webinar and its learnings with your social networks. This curated series on innovations will feature a variety of industry thought leaders, speakers like Mr. Amitabh Ray, who are a part of the MIT IT Innovation ecosystem. For those who are joining us for the first time today, I'd like to inform you that MIT stands for the 4-decade-old Maharashtra Institute of Technology. ID stands for MIT's 15-year-old pioneering Institute of Design. And MIT IT's one-year innovation program focuses on the 4 pillars of design, business, technology, and humanities. The key features and differentiators of this one-year course are immersions, project-based learning, and humanities. So at the MIT IT innovation program, industry and academia come together to create a new breed of comprehensive innovators. Those who are informed by design thinking, influenced by future technologies and trends, and inspired to make their own mark in the global scenario, be it political, social, economic, or technological. So we welcome you all once again to this thoughtfully curated innovation journey. Amitabh, we warmly welcome you once again. Thank you so much for your time. And here we go. So looking forward to know more from you about innovations in times of crisis. Over to you, please.
Thanks, Priya. And thanks everybody for joining and giving me the opportunity to come and share some of my learning. I thought a lot about what we can talk about innovation, and this is a series going on. I'm sure all of you are hearing from different speakers, different aspects of innovation. But now here we are during an unprecedented crisis situation. So what I thought is, I'll talk about the economic value of COVID-19, distance dynamics, innovation in times of crisis. Because we sometimes think that during such crisis, things like innovation stops, and because we cannot go to office and we cannot work. But let's talk about how we see innovation, going great distances in the times of crisis now, which you'll come to know later, but what happened in the past. So coming from a company which has innovation at its core, we at Ericsson, we invented most of the things you can see today and use in your day-to-day life in terms of mobile communication, inventing the first mobile phone, inventing the mobile broadband, and of course the technology like Bluetooth, which all of us use, were invented by Ericsson as a company. We have the highest amount of patents in our technology area. Any mobile phone you use or any mobile communication platform you use, they are using some of our patents. So no company can create any mobile device without paying the royalty to Ericsson for using our technology. So the company is over 140 years old and has huge amount of innovation in the area of mobile communication. What we also do, we use our patents with all other companies to take them and use them in their technology. But that's another topic. Today we are talking about innovation in times of crisis. I'll try to share a couple of stories from my own life. It was one of the first major challenges in my life to lead a project for a Big Four consulting company. And that was Pricewaterhouse I was working. And I was leading a large project for the firm. And for all practical purpose, that project was given up for a failure. It risked the firm's reputation where I was working at that point in time. And any hope of breaking into the growing business of information technology outsourcing was coming to an end almost, because this was our first major project. I was leading a team into this great unknown. There was this gigantic, complex project plan, which was far too focused on all kinds of complex trackers, dashboard, but little to do with execution. The first thing I did was literally throw the plan out of the window. We broke up the challenges into smaller pieces and slowly, bit by bit, worked to execute those pieces to the very best of our ability. This made the crisis look less daunting and more manageable. The entire focus of the team was on execution of those small pieces and taking each day as it came. Over time, the strategy worked and the bits neatly fitted into a solution that delivered on promise. Since then, it has been taking each day as it comes throughout my career. It became my mantra for survival, and success was the only byproduct without having to focus on it. Right now, the mantra seems to be working, and I'm keeping my fingers crossed. When we are faced with the worst global health crisis ever, hunkering down in the relative safety of our homes, working over video conferences like this, telephone calls, we are slowly trying to navigate through the crisis and finding out how to land on our feet once this is over, and perhaps discover new ways to stay competitive and continue delivering value to our customers, society, and our people. This is a time for crisis-induced innovation. But first, let us understand the nature of this emergency COVID-19 is a technical term. It's like a crisis we have never faced before in our lifetime. No country is immune from it. Hundreds and thousands of lives have been lost. Millions more are at risk. The world has hit a pause button that is threatening our livelihoods. It's like we have put our economics in a self-induced corona coma. The International Monetary Fund has sounded the alarm bell for this coma, warning that this recession is even worse than the Great Depression faced by the US in 1929-30, and certainly far more serious than 2008 financial meltdown. A global pandemic of this nature is different from the economic crisis that we faced earlier. The Great Depression or the dot-com burst of 2000 and 2008 financial meltdown were triggered by single events which lasted for a few weeks or months. The crisis then unfolded over a period of time. The COVID-19 pandemic is a crisis that keeps on coming in waves. It peaks, plateaus, spikes uncompromisingly. Just when countries might think they have passed the peak, it might resurface, catching us off the ground. The world is faced with an unparalleled paradox. If we stay at home, the virus stops spreading. But this means that economic activities are frozen, putting our livelihood at risk. And what about innovation then? During the past economic crisis, human endeavors continued relentlessly to find new ways of survival and even innovate. Harvard political economist Joseph Schumpeter long ago argued that crises were seabeds of innovation and entrepreneurship. Innovations developed during crises generate the cults of creative destruction that launch new technologies, remake, you know, existing things in a different way, in a better way. During this economic crisis in the past, the human endeavor continued relentlessly to find new ways of survival and even innovate. And I was kind of referring the economist who tracked the patents granted between 1901 to 2005, which clearly show that there was spikes in innovative activities during the long depression of 1870s and 1880s and the Great Depression of 1930s. Things like the magnetic tape recorder, helicopter, nylon, ballpoint pen were milestone innovations during 1929 depression. So moving on to the next chart, which talks about, okay, what's common in these companies? You know, this trend of finding treasures out of debris of economic downturn have always continued. The recession of early 1990s hit hard in the UK, lasting for almost 3 years. ARM, previously Advanced Risk Machine, were founded right near the beginning of that dip. Processor based on its design now powered the most of the smartphone and tablet computers in the world. Microsoft even was founded in New Mexico in April of 1975, right after the end of recession that kicked off in 1973, 2 years before. And then they reincorporated in Washington State in June of 1981, just at the deep recession of the early 1980s started. That point in time, also, technology companies saw a huge amount of innovation. Another example, Dave Hewlett and Bill Packard from their company, formed their company in a garage in 1939. When the effect of Great Recession was still lingering. 2008-2009 financial meltdown found the trend unbattered. Back in October 2007, Housemate, Brian Chesky, and Joe Gebbia were unable to pay their rent, so they turned their living room into a bed and breakfast and set up a website charging $80 per person. In 2008, they got former roommate and TechWiz Nathan on board. And the side airbedandbreakfast.com officially launched on August 11, 2008. In 2009, the site name was shortened to airbnb.com. Even WhatsApp was founded in 2009 during that financial crisis. True innovators are seldom daunted by economic conditions. By the middle of 2001, the dot-com bubble had burst, leaving a sour taste in the mouths of many when it came to do anything involving new technology. But that didn't stop Apple's Steve Jobs and his team to whip up a prototype for a new personal music player, a gadget later dubbed as iPod. Launched on October 23, 2001, just after 1 year of development, the 5GB allowed music lover to put 1,000 songs in their pocket. Thomas Edison and company launched General Electric, heading into the panic of 1893. A period of 16 months where business activity dropped nearly 40% across the nation. Nevertheless, the company persisted and went on to be one of the original 12 companies listed on Dow Jones Industrial Average in 1896, where it renamed and remained for over a century. Launched as the Computing Tabulating Recording Company, CTR, by Charles Flint in the June of 1911, got its start selling commercial and business machines right in the middle of a long 2 year pandemic. And it was a panic time. Digit decline in activity, CTR was able not only to survive but thrive, eventually changing its name to IBM and becoming the leader in technology that would support the digital revolution, making billions along the way. If you think of other companies, like in 2001 in US recession, it was 8 months of economic downturn that began in March and lasted through November. While economy recovered in the fourth quarter of that year, that impact lingered and the national unemployment continued to climb, reaching 6% in US in June of 2003. It was during this time Facebook was created. Google, as you all know, in 1998, when the world drew to a close, the world was caught in the grip of the most serious financial crisis since the Great Depression in 1930. It started in Thailand in 1997 and crisis spread to rest of Asia, part of Latin America, Russia over the next 18 months. By the end of the year, it posed a direct threat to US economy. But then during the same time, Google was born. Moving on to the next chart, the COVID-19 challenge will spark another round of innovation. And I'm a strong believer of that. And that we all will witness once this crisis is over. And some of it will happen during the crisis as well. Let's accept the fact that coronavirus will continue to be in our system even after a vaccine has been discovered, like many other viruses which killed millions, but were later tackled with vaccine and modern medicine. COVID-19 too will most likely follow a similar pattern. As this happens, people will continue to practice physical distancing. This in turn will result in surge of technologies and innovation that minimizes human contact and automate the entire process in one sweep. The fourth industrial revolution has been collapsed into few years. Instead of panning out over decades, Industry 4.0 will be driven by what I call the distant dynamics, which is using our need for physical distance to create new value proposition. We are already seeing autonomous robots tackle some of the challenges of this pandemic in medical institution, such as providing ultraviolet light to clean the room and surfaces, hence not putting cleaning staff at risk of infection. Of course, the same technology that is used to clean infrastructure can also be safely applied to any robot. In buildings, such as hospital delivery, robots can and could be used to ferry equipment and supplies, and we are already seeing that. This is already happening for room service in some hotel, in pre-pandemic era and is now used to deliver self-isolating people, sheltering there, providing a further safety barrier. I would say future has arrived. COVID-19 is already having a direct fallout in speeding up the processes of automation, driven by the need to reduce physical contact between human. Already, a Chinese e-commerce giant tested a level four autonomous delivery robot in Wuhan and operated 24/7 warehouses to cope with surge demand. A level four vehicle, what it means? It can move autonomously on a particular trajectory and under specific conditions that are generally made known in advance. On a given trajectory, for example, on a highway or a known route, driver does not need to be behind the wheel and can take his attention away from the road. This level is also called mind off. Every company must consider what it can digitally transform and what it can automate. This also won't be the last pandemic. So this crisis acts as a wake-up call for everyone to fast-track adoption of useful technology and innovation. And that includes augmented reality, AI, 3D printing, and autonomous robots. As physical contacts reduce, we will see a massive rise in popularity of multiplayer video games. Revenues from online games are expected to touch US$17 billion in 2020. This is a pre-COVID estimate. The use of augmented and virtual reality will scientifically boost this market and post-COVID-19. Now, the same technology will have a tremendous impact on learning and education as well. Distance learning will become the norm rather than an option. Technologies like 3D projection, holograms, will allow a single teacher to deliver lectures in different classrooms across countries. This has been a long-standing promise, but we now will see a crisis push to crush the innovation time to meet the urgent needs of the day. Regulation for providing telehealth, remote medical analytics are being relaxed to ease the pressure on physicians. You don't need to stretch your imagination that these technologies will be the standard in conferencing and remote working in our offices. Innovation in our ways of working will happen, as right now we are working 100% from home in that mode. We won't get back to the past normal even when the threat of COVID-19 is not there. All organizations will discover their individual blend of percentages of employee needed to be present in the office and those whose role can be done from working from home. This will, of course, lead to a reassessment of roles and responsibilities. Leadership, which used to large term, has to also be transformed. The way we used to define leadership, team sizes will become much smaller. Remote management will not be possible otherwise. Outcome-based management will replace the current industrial age managerial practices that depend on physical supervision of the employees to ensure completion of a task. When it comes to shows and conferences, employees are no longer expected to attend events. They have attended in the past, but that's it. A lot of companies will save several billions of money and by people experiencing working from home and attending such events. We need to improve the home networking. That is very clear. And better home office equipment, furnitures, and that will drive change in opportunity for some vendors. However, overall experience is what needs upgrading. Plenty of collaboration tools vendors see as their moment. All collaboration tool vendors, like the platform we are using, it's a boom time for them, and they are driving a lot of innovation at the back of this pandemic crisis. But over and above the collaboration tool hype, there will be a bounce back for work management converged and intelligent workspace and employee engagement tools. There will be investment and innovation in those areas as well. Simply transitioning physical to virtual events by streaming sessions with some kind of Q&A won't cut it as a feasible long-term platform. All companies, institutes, will need to explore new ways to attract, engage, and connect audience digitally, as well as demonstrate enough value to attend. Opt-in delegate chat, demos, webinars have been mostly digital, fourth to physical events. The challenge now is to turn these and other kind of devices into what delegates will want to interact with and in. The big push will come in the Internet of Things and robotics process automation in manufacturing. We were already witnessing factories with negligible number of employees with assembly line processes controlled by robot arms. This will now become commonplace. However, it will have huge adverse social impact as employment opportunities in these areas will shrink, while reskilling and upskilling for employees will have to be taken up by organizations. This will also lead to disruption and new thinking in the political systems. Around the world, governments are now doing things that 3 months ago looked impossible. Let's take some example. In Spain, private hospitals have been nationalized. In UK, prospect of nationalizing various modes of transports have been very, very real. And in France, they have stated its readiness to nationalize large businesses. A form of state socialism seems to be coming in place. But who knows what's there in future. Likewise, we are seeing breakdown in labor market. Countries like Denmark and UK are providing people with an income in order to stop these laborers from going to work. This is an essential part of a successful lockdown. India too, taking measures to protect its companies from being subject to global takeovers. Direct benefits of food and cash being transferred to citizens. Once again, a form of universal basic income or UBI seems to have taken shape. Something that was envisioned to take care of people who would have lost their job in the technological disruption of fourth industrial revolution. COVID-19, which has been disastrous for humanity, also unleashed extraordinary global collaboration involving companies, research organizations, countries to battle this crisis, in which we are all together and have to come out as one. Healthcare organizations are collaborating with technology companies and research outfits to find cure for the pandemic. Pharma giant GSK has joined force with Sanofi, bringing together two of the world's largest vaccine companies in an unprecedented collaboration to fight COVID-19. In our world of technology, Apple and Google are pooling their technologies to find solution to contact tracing. This is breaking silos of R&Ds among various companies. And we expect that not only we will find the vaccine, but the fallout of economic gains will be substantial. Collaboration as a strategy to survive a crisis was also noticed in the earlier periods of economic distress. Organizational characteristics like exploring new market opportunity, swimming against the tide, using methods of technological appropriation, working with suppliers to reconfigure supply chain, all these things were a winner in post-COVID-19 era. These are the things which will be the winners. Losers are most likely to be found among those firms. They react just by reducing employment and productive capacity in general, but also downsizing their investment in innovation. The rapidly evolving situation today is a tailor-made to work out the mantra of each day at a time. No one has a crystal ball about the future. this is an unprecedented crisis, the likes of which we haven't seen earlier. There are no solution or solution templates to apply to something that the world hasn't experienced before. We can at best draw inspiration from organizations which have managed well during post-crisis and emerged stronger. The only way we can survive is to take each day at a time, doing our best in the situation, preparing for a long haul, and never giving up on our basic principles. Being compassionate in dealing with our people, stakeholders, and continue to value the basic purpose of being in business, to deliver technology for good of this planet. I have worked in 3-century organizations which have gone through all 3 industrial revolutions and have stayed stronger by being faithful to their values. This will also be true this time. The world must be ready to recap the dividend from distant dynamics that will drive businesses of tomorrow. So I'll end here, and thanks for your patient hearing, and I'll be happy to take if you have any question or comment. Over to you, Pierre.
Thank you so much. So Ericsson Global Services has more employees in India, I believe, than in any other country. Are we right on that?
Yes, Ericsson as a whole in India, we have more employees, even more than what we have in our headquarters country in Sweden.
I see. And these are almost about some 20,000 approximately employees. What are the most recent HR initiatives do you think which are coming into place now courtesy of the COVID-19 scenario at Ericsson?
There are plenty of things. There are plenty of things from an HR perspective we are looking at. Our first priority is safety of our people. So we are trying to ensure that people work from home as much as possible.
So I think we'll move on with the questions which have come in.
Yeah.
How do you compare this crisis to that of 2008? When do you see the economic trough to come? So I think this could be also in line with that. It's been, I think, close to a decade for you now at Ericsson. So maybe you could sort of draw parallels in terms of what was it like to be, joining Ericsson around the same time. And you've by and large seen so many disruptions through the decade. So how would you compare these crises? Yeah, thank you.
Thanks. It's a very good question. I would say that I've been through a number of crises in my career. And of course, 2008 was one of them, but it started in September 2001. Soon after I returned from US, the largest global terror attack took place in US. And that was one of the huge crises, I had to handle. Okay, so it started soon after I came back from US in 2001, and I was putting my first large proposal for an offshore work. And that evening, I was supposed to give the final presentation and we'll agree with the customer. And by 5:30 or so, somebody came and said that, this terror attack happened in US, the Twin Tower collapsed. All my plans for the next few months gone haywire. And because you cannot plan based on this kind of crisis, right? So the project didn't happen. It had impact on the financials and all. And then the other interesting disruption I personally went through is the Enron bankruptcy in December 2001. That triggered the largest collapse of financial system in the US, a collapse of Arthur Andersen. It impacted me personally in a big way because that was the time Security Exchange Commission in the US, they asked all the big 4 consulting companies to hive up their consulting business, and PwC sold their consulting business, IBM bought it, and my world changed. I suddenly changed the company. That was in October 2002 because of that disruption, right? But right. What you are questioning is September 2008, the Lehman Brothers collapse, mm-hmm. the biggest US recession, and then it started with the US and it created a financial crisis all around the world. The first thing happened is our customers got impacted. There was a huge downsizing happened globally, including our company, and a customer tried to reduce their spend in everything. So all the new projects we were expecting to come never came. We lined up a lot of new joinees from different campuses. We had to hire them, and we definitely hired them. But then we really, really struggled to keep them meaningfully engaged. So what we did during that period, and what I was kind of describing in my presentation also, that we created some small projects internally, A, to keep them busy, B, to train them, but never thought that outcome of some projects, which this new joinees or the college grads, they created, will be so meaningfully used down the line. So we kind of asked them to standardize some of the processes, in a smaller way in those good old days, automate some of the scripts and all, and they have done it. And we used that opportunity to gain more market share than our competition, who never invested in things like that going forward. Even today, when I talk about this, it's very interesting that soon after this crisis became global, the first newsletter came from our company's CEO, Boris Yahyakov, and he said that we are not reducing a single penny in our R&D investment. All you can expect that will increase, because we are a technology company, we'll have to keep increasing our spend on R&D, because that is what is going to move us forward and further than our competition. So companies who will invest like that, and we invested like that in 2008, showed much better results than others.
True. Thank you so much. We have a question from Tejasri Apte. How can we convince people to use the new technologies after launching the product, which has innovative ideas? Because mostly people are so used to the earlier idea. So how can we make people adapt quickly?
Yeah, I think you'll have to find what is the USP or unique selling feature of your product, right? So every product should cater to some basic need of human being, right? So it has to be helpful to them as a consumer in one way or the other. So you'll have to focus on that. And I believe today the people who in the smaller setup innovating and creating new products, the opportunities are way, way more than before because of this digitalization, right? Internet made it possible that you can reach to the set of people using the net without spending much money, which a large company can also reach out. Like, those barriers are not there anymore, that you'll have to have large marketing budget and investment and advertising. Okay, so that is one of the biggest opportunity today. And it has changed the way large companies to look at, especially the consumer product company and technology companies, that how to do their product launch, right? So let's say in movies, it is not about only the big stars and the big movie theaters. They're launching their movies on Friday prime time. With the invention of platforms like Netflix, you know, small time stars and small companies, producers, they're putting their movies and they're challenging this mainstream, the movie corporations, right? So I think today it's much easier for us to reach out to people, but you have to focus to your core of your product, why someone should use it. And if it has a distinct advantage and benefit, I'm sure, you know, people will start using it.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you so much. We'll take one more question now before we conclude the webinar. This one's by Anshuman Thakur. He says that how one should plan scenario planning framework approach considering the current lockdown and containment, considering the budget planning was already done before March 2020. So if you could please share your inputs and guide him.
Yeah, I think it's also a very interesting question and a very important one.
Right.
So companies who never factored in such you know, crisis during their budget preparation, I believe those companies will have to relook at the budget and you know, somehow ensure that they convince their shareholders that it requires the revision, and if it's a listed company, needs to also convey the message to the street, right, the financial community. That is the only way. I believe that time has not come yet for most of us to change the budget or the target one way or the other, because we have not seen the full impact of it. So maybe in another quarter's time, companies will do it. I can talk about my own company. On 20th of this month, we published our quarter one result, and we kind of told the investors that we still believe that we will be able to deliver what we have promised in terms of our margin and profitability and top line and bottom line. So there will be companies who will be delivering. Some companies might be overperforming because they have something which is very crucial for people's usage in today's time, right? But some company will have to reinstate their financials, of course, maybe most of them.
Right. Thank you so much. So we do see more questions coming in, but I would request all participants that please do reach out to me offline, possibly on LinkedIn. We'll get the dots connected and we'll have your questions answered offline. We conclude here. A round of thanks to our participants for joining us today. We were pretty much 100 plus. And special thanks to our guest speaker, Mr. Amitabh Ray, for his time and sharing valued insights. And sorry about the technical glitches from Zoom's end. We will definitely keep them posted in terms of the customer interface issues we face today. And for those who tuned in late, we would like to inform you that this curated series on innovations will feature a variety of industry thought leaders, senior guest speakers like Mr. Amitabh Ray, who are now a part of the MIT ID innovation ecosystem. MIT stands for the 4-decade-old Maharashtra Institute of Technology. ID stands for MIT's 15-year-old pioneering institute of design. And MIT ID's one-year innovation program focuses on the four pillars of design, business, technology, humanities. There's a lot to be discussed across all these four parameters. And I think the discussions can be endless on the need for innovation in the current challenging times. So we encourage you to connect with us via our social channels. The links were provided at the start of the chat. Do stay connected, stay safe, stay home. And also one last update, that there are last few seats left for the second cohort of this prestigious program that MIT ID innovation team offers, which will fast track your career path. So thank you once again, Amitabh. Thank you so much for your time. And yes, we will continue the discussions in the days to come.
Thanks.
Pleasure.
Bye, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.